All right, so we are back, and yep, I'm working on the set. Things are changing here at the Wade Concept. In today's video, I wanna do something that we haven't done in a while, and that's break down some sparring footage. But it's not a normal sparring breakdown. I wanna break down the footage of a man that has changed over time. A former kickboxing world champion multiple times over, regardless of what you think about the organization he did it in or how inflated kickboxing records are. They are, but motherfucker won world titles. And obviously, the man that then changed into an inmate in Romanian prison because of investigations that are, I think, still going on. I have no idea what's going on with that situation, but Andrew Tate is no longer the fighter he once was. And my question always has been, with the influencer boxing scene being what it is, with the likes of especially Logan Paul and KSI saying they may want to fight with Andrew Tate, I want to see what them hands do for Andrew Tate. Not from his kickboxing world title pass, not with any kicks involved at all. I wanna see right now, is Andrew Tate a good boxer? Good enough to beat Logan Paul, as I've previously predicted he would, or potentially, even at his age, which I think is in his late 30s, be able to win pro boxing matches versus competent competition? That's the question of the day. Can Andrew Tate box right now? The breakdown. Let's go. So like I said, I've seen Andrew Tate's boxing style before, at least in a kickboxing setting. And this is way before he went to jail and way before the OnlyFans cam girl stuff. But that's why I want to do this. Can he still do, or does he have the same sort of ability that he did previously? And that's a couple things we're going to look for. Is he still explosive? Because I've seen him be pretty damn powerful with his punches, knocking foes out dead. Number two, with apparently an eye injury that I think a lot of you guys have told me he's either blind in one eye or he can't see, is he still aware of all things in front of him, and how does he compensate for that unseeable eye? Number three, he's older now, so does he still have reflexes like he did as a youth? And again, a lot of his fighting style, with a neck as long as mine is, I'm a goddamn giraffe. Can he still use a lot of his head movement, even with his hands low, to get out of the way of punches? We're gonna take a look at all that. But first, I wanna hear how Andrew Tate explains boxing, because I think he has an interesting take on it.
Two weapons, you're right-handed. You got a sniper rifle, and you got a machine gun. Machine gun you can miss sometimes. Sniper rifle you got here.
Fire! I love this, because he's not referring to boxing in terms that people don't necessarily understand. And yeah, I'm gonna get on Andrew Tate's nuts for a second, because a little bit goes a long way when you're teaching the sport of boxing. Instead of being like, okay, what's your dominant hand? Here's your jab, here's your cross. You have a hook, you have an uppercut. You can shoulder roll, you can high guard, you can low. That stuff's too complicated for someone that's never understood the sport. And everyone knows that a machine gun is providing a prrrr, which you should do with your jab. And like he said, you can afford to miss some of those shots because of the rapid succession of shots behind it, the continued volume of those shots. And again, I love the comparison, because yes, you better hit that motherfucking shot you shoot with a sniper rifle, because that shell's coming out, ba-ding, and then you gotta fucking, okay. And you gotta sit that bitch down and reload it again. You don't have the opportunity to throw it or land it or hit with that shot or with your right hand to the same variety or the same consistency as your jab. I love that.
The difference between a machine gun and a sniper rifle is the reload time, right? A machine gun you can miss, because you can just quickly reload it. Sniper rifle, you got from bolt action, all this bollocks. Exactly the same thing. Every single weapon has a reload time. So when you're fighting as a professional, the reason I don't just go in there and start swinging is because if I miss, there's a huge reload time, and I'm gonna get hurt, right?
Well, you're definitely not gonna get hurt if he throws that. Again, I know we're demonstrating, but
if I miss, there's a huge reload.
A man threw the squared up clothesline. He was trying out for the WWE.
And I'm gonna get hurt, right? So your quickest weapon that has the lowest reload time is jab. It's gonna be your left hand. So a boxing stance is left foot forward, right foot back, the heels of your feet.
That man, listen, I'm just saying, that man Tate got some calves on him, son. I ain't talking about he grew up on the farm either, son. To be expected out of a Muay Thai fighter, but I'm miring, all right? I'm miring.
You shouldn't touch the ground. Your front heel can sometimes, but in general, perfect technique, your heels don't touch the ground. It's all in the balls of your feet. So it's like calf activation. When I was training, he put ink on our heels. And if he saw ink on the mat, we all got fucked. So heel can't touch the mat for hours. Because when your heels are off the mat, you're the most springy, you're the most bouncy. You can move quick, right? Your right hand is gonna go up.
Very interesting about the heels not being on the ground. That's interesting. Because some of the most dominant fighters in history have been mobile fighters, but especially with boxing, the mobility is the smaller movement, and a lot of it is upper body movement. Think Floyd Mayweather, who would stand almost flat-footed in front of guys at points and just shoulder roll and use his upper body to not only save energy in his lower body, but also to give the perception that he could be hit. So that all of his pulling and moving with his upper body was the thing that made him elude shots and still be in range to fire back. So that's interesting. That sounds more Muay Thai to me. That sounds more kickboxing to me. But being on the balls of your feet and being mobile is important. So fair play.
And it's going to guard your chin. Your left hand is going to be out a little bit more forward. And the very basic premise of boxing is find him with your jab. And as soon as you find him, you throw a power shot. That's boxing. Very simple version. Look. Now, there's a thousand different little technical changes we can make to make that better, but that's the basis of boxing. And the idea is, if you can't...
I mean, to a degree, yeah, he's right. You do range fine with your jab to throw your power shot, whether it's a backhand, whether it's a lead hook, whether it's an uppercut, whatever it is. But the other side of that is the sweet science. The general rule of boxing is to hit and not be hit, right? He's talking about the offense almost exclusively here because that's the fun part to talk about. But the other side of that is to hit and not be hit, which is dependent upon your jab and a little bit of the footwork he was talking about, but yes.
A bullet is so deadly, not because of the amount of pressure it has, but because it's such a small surface. If you reduce the surface area, you increase the pressure. So what most people do when they throw a punch, they don't think about how their hand lands. So stay still. If I land with the flat of my hand, or if I land with one knuckle, you feel the difference. It's the same amount of force. But it's concentrated, you see? Mm-hmm. So if you whack, whoosh, and it's one knuckle, it snaps the bone. And that's why you twist, because it aligns your knuckle. It aligns your knuckle better. If you keep it straight, it's going to be the flat of your hand.
Andrew Tate relating all boxing to bullets is awesome. But it's kind of true. Like, there's easier ways to explain it than sometimes guys like me that are behind the fucking keyboard going, well, if you throw that hand and it lands this way, here is how you do it better. But what Tate says here about turning his fist over, yes, there is an application to touch the button, right? Everyone has one on the chin, behind the ear, temple, wherever it is where concussive impact will rattle your brain, cause a whiplash effect, and knock you f***ing out cold.
So you jab, if you miss, bring it back. Don't go and leave it out here, because you're gonna be open for a right hand, see? See, the right hand can come over the top, bang. So jab, if you miss, back. If you touch, as soon as it comes back, right hand forward. You missed, you gotta catch me. Don't catch me. It's like a chicken with Rocky. You ever seen Rocky where you have to chase a chicken? It's the same game. Boom, there goes the right hand. So you missed. You didn't throw it. You landed.
Yeah.
It was the right hand.
So you touch, you always follow.
You got to train your brain. That if this touches something, that follows. Because if you touch me with this, you know where I am. And you know I'm there. And you know that command. And this is going to be longer than your jab. This is going to be all the way long, like this. And you're going to pivot, twist on your foot. Boom, all the way through. If your jab misses, you don't want to throw that because it's going to be open for counters. If you land the jab, whack.
Now, this is just a short piece that we're going to get into in a second when Tate actually spars some, I think, heavyweight boxers, but it shows you a little bit of Tate's defense right here, right? It's very much hands low, a lot of weight on the front foot, even as he's going backward to look to counter, right? So it's a lot of weight in front, waiting, boom, he wants to counter behind stuff. And again, normally, as a boxer, you want to have those hands a little higher like he was telling this guy to have, and this is a bit of an over-exaggerated, let me keep my fists right here because it's what I've been told to do and not moving them until I punch. But what Tate does is a little more risky versus high-level guys, but as someone gets to range, he knows when to protect himself. As soon as that jab comes, he throws his high guard up.
Good.
And again, you see more of a Muay Thai defense here. So this is, again, Andrew Tate blending the two, right? So you see him more bending at the waist here and straight back versus, again, a beginner that's just trying to land a punch on him and he's having no success doing it. But a competent boxer will use his feet behind these punches to keep that range and also close it so that when you do lean just purely at the waist, like Andrew Tate does a lot, the follow-up punches are in range and can't hurt you.
Good. Right, now we're on the hooks. There's two kinds of hooks. You can hook like this, which is all about the knuckle, like we talked about. So there's less physical power because the way your arm works. Doesn't have as much force, but your knuckle lands better. Mm-hmm. Or you can hook like this, which is more physical force, but it's harder to get the knuckle in. So that's more personal preference. You're probably gonna like to hook like this. It's more natural. Jab?
True. The thumb up hook versus the thumb in hook is a widely debated technique for throwing, especially your lead hand. There are guys like Triple G and Manny Pacquiao that chop down with their hooks in can generate a ton of power, also landing flush with those two inside knuckles. And like Tate says, really concentrating that force onto one pinpoint spot that can turn your fucking lights out. Or the thumb up hook, which is still devastating. If you catch someone on the chin, they're going to sleep. But it does generate a lot of power because you are twisting and your arm comes across like it normally would in any other exchange versus trying to turn that shoulder over and limiting a bit of that mobility. As you get further and further out, it becomes less and less natural to throw, where the hook can still remain somewhat natural and fluid.
Oh, you're going.
Good, good.
Again. Good. Draw my hand up. Nice. Right.
All right, so there's Andrew Tate teaching the sport of boxing. And by the way, at the end of that video, that guy is throwing not the greatest punches ever, but he's learning pretty quickly because Andrew Tate's a pretty damn good teacher. But now let's see him put it into practice, because again, we're talking about a multi-time world champion kickboxer back in his time. But now he's retired, and at age 37, how much can he still have in the tank? And would it be enough to not only be at the best of the influencer boxing scene, but would it be enough to compete just as a professional at all? All right, so there's some music on here that I can't play, but we're still gonna watch this and take a look. So this is Andrew Tate destroys pro boxers. Immediately, we start with two guys trading jabs here, right? Tate eats one, and so does the opponent. Both guys trade here. And again, you do see Andrew Tate has never really been shy, even in his past fights, about getting into exchanges. He's a taller guy, so usually reaches at an advantage for him, but both guys exchange there and they both get tagged. A lot of bait right here from Andrew Tate. And you've seen some of the better boxers with their reactions, guys that are reaction-based, do a lot of this where they'll pull out that backhand and try to reach out to gather range, but also, I want you to throw your jab so I can counter with something, whether it's my jab, my hook, or just moving back behind that throwing combination. This is kind of what Tate does by pawing out that backhand like that. Because again, right there, you see ready for the attack and ready to set up and fire back. All done with the idea of countering. Jab to the body. Hey, I like that. Gives him the, you know, like subtle, slower jab to the body. Like, okay, I'm just feeling you out. And then boom, snaps on him, lands that. You can see it in the background here. Lands a flush hook right on the temple. So Tate's still fucking fast. Like, he's quick. This is another thing that I've seen from Tate, which again, I'm going to be nitpicky because I consider him very good and good enough for me to do this. When he exits clinches, right? Exits with the shove and the hands down and almost gets caught for it there. This is something I've seen from him in some of his past stuff, but still has a decent enough reaction time to be able to get out of the way of that shot. And again, here is a little bit of the flaw with Tate being so overzealous sometimes with his hands low, right? He gets into a little bit of a flurry here and eats a right hand on the way out. Now, it doesn't hurt him, but it's the same thing he just told the guy he was training a second ago, is leaving exchanges with your hands down will allow for something like that to happen. Hey, good right hand. Jab, and again, the right hand comes over the top here. Doesn't quite get to Tate, but that's partially because of, again, solid technique with his jab. He doesn't bring it back all the way, but that shoulder is aligned with his chin enough to protect him. And he does turn with that right hand a bit, right? So it kind of glances off, and then he lands a big straight right hand right off that jab. All in all, like I said, I thought that was a good little display there from Tate of head movement, being in the fire without being afraid of being hit. Now, that doesn't mean you want to take a bunch of punches. Like, this is not a Saturday night out with the boys. You're not trying to take a lot of shots. But him being able to just live in the fire right there and still maintain reaction time and ability to think and plan shots and maneuver at different speeds is, again, pretty telling as to how good this guy, even at 37, still is. Gets hit with the right hand there, though. And this is, again, one of the things when Tate does get a little bit overzealous and tries to extend, even while being at such close range, he'll eat some. Interesting thing Tate likes to do here, too, when he feels his creativity is kind of done, right, where he doesn't feel like he can be as creative or he doesn't have the space to move around. And if this was an actual boxing ring, maybe he's up against the ropes here. He initiates this clinch, right? Okay, cool. Then, while in the clinch, plans that next attack. Because again, boxing almost specifically, being the taller guy, you wouldn't think that Tate would have the advantage in this situation, right? In the clinch, where the punches are a little shorter, he can get caught with some uppercuts here, you know, things like that. But Tate uses his opportunity, which I think is genius, to put the weight on the guy, make him kind of hold that weight with that high guard, and opens up a nice little liver shot here. Boom. Beautiful. Now we're heating up a little bit. Now we're cooking with grease. Goes to the body again with that last one. Hey, come on, son. I will sell my firstborn for a pull counter like that. One of the most effective defense to offense transitions is a well-timed, very minimal movement pull counter And Tate does that with the right hand here. It's one of the most beautiful things in combat sports, in my opinion. Combination punching is awesome. Dog fights are dope. Body shots are the best. A great knockout is, of course, the spectacular fan favorite. But to me, one of the most impressive things is the ability to be calm and composed in the fire, enough to be able to bait a shot out, pull just enough out of range to still be in range to counterattack and land flush. This is what I like, man. And again, you see it. Weight on the front foot. Boom. Slips and throws that bitch right down the pipe. Gets out of the way of his opponents. He might not have landed it as clean as I originally thought, but the idea of it is fantastic, man. That is just gorgeous work. Head off the center as well. His opponent gets through with the right hand a little bit, glancing. But Tate, I think, lands that one more clean. Just a great shot. And then to the body. Gets out of the way. Nope. And again, good head movement. Just reaction time. And then just keeps going to the body, man. Which you love to see, because how many guys actually utilize that? Nah, we in the midst of it now. Oh, shit. We're getting spicy. Oh! Woo! Look at this. All right. Makes him miss with the lead hand. Cool. Now, catches him with the lead hook. Avoids the right hand. Still looking to attack. That pullback and throw. Again, crazy reaction. Also, while switching stance. Nutty, dude. Now we're in southpaw. Right hand. Left body shot. Right hand again behind that. What? All accurate, too. Let's play it one more time. I know I paused it a lot, but just look at this in real time. Boom, 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 boom. Crazy, dude. All right, so third sparring partner, and oh, buddy, this fool is huge. So we progressively got bigger with the sparring partners, which I like, because Andrew Tate's what, 6'4"? Definitely a cruiserweight, and this guy is definitely, from what I'm seeing, either a cruiser or potentially a heavyweight. All right, working that jab already. You can see already the speed difference, right? Which, again, is something you have to admire about Tate. Tate is 6'3", 205, and he has speed like a light heavyweight. All right. Boom. Right hand gets out of there quick enough. Goes back to the jab. Looking to set up that right hand with his jab there. Doesn't actually throw it there, interestingly enough. He gets close enough to easily land this right hand. Double jab. Right hand. Way. That one hurt. Right hand through the guard. And this is, again, all set up off of that jab. That jab that he's been tripling and doubling up. He doubles it up here. Then one more behind it. Look how close he is to range. Boom. Right hand through the guard. Nice work. All right, so there you have it. Andrew Tate. Can he box at the ripe age of 37? Which is not very far from my age. I'm 31, talking like I'm young. I'm definitely not. But the answer is yeah, dude. Andrew Tate can absolutely box at an influencer boxing level for sure. I've said this for the last year and some change now, and I'll keep by it. People were asking about Andrew Tate and Logan Paul, and even the description of this video, which just came out a couple weeks ago, was like, Tate versus Logan Paul, who wins? It is very clear to me that Andrew Tate is far and away better than somebody like a Logan Paul, and I'm going to say this, and people aren't going to like it. Him and KSI, because of Andrew Tate's size, and again, his reactionary ability is a little bit more unorthodox than someone like KSI has ever fought, and his willingness to be in the fire with somebody like that, probably going to go to Andrew Tate there. Now, him and Jake, because Jake is a little bit more boxing centric and will offer some issues with a lot of the hands down kind of style of an Andrew Tate, would be a little bit more of an interesting matchup for Tate. But I do think that Andrew Tate not only has hands but could provide them to the influencer boxing scene. As a pro, no, he wouldn't be a world champion, not at this age and years of mileage on his body, but he wouldn't be some 0-100 journeyman either. He'd be like a, you know, middle of the pack, somewhat decent pro boxer. But I don't think he cares about that. He obviously still has aspirations on boxing some of these influencers, and I'm saying, why not? Can we get Andrew Tate in an influencer boxing ring? I want to see it. I think you guys would want to see it. The question is, who's it going to be? The obvious choice has got to be Logan Paul. That's the one that obviously Andrew Tate wants. Logan, on the other hand, doesn't seem to want any part of that, because he claims he doesn't want to give Andrew Tate a platform after fighting Dylan Danis. Or you have KSI, who did call out Andrew Tate, but I don't think is realistically wanting to take that fight. So I don't know. Jake seems like the only person that would do it, and I don't know that Andrew Tate even wants to fight Jake, so maybe not. Maybe not. But comment section, you let me know. Would you like to see Andrew Tate in the ring? What do you think of his skills? And just how good a boxer is Andrew Tate? I've provided my answers, but the question still remains, will we get him in a strictly boxing ring? Hopefully the influencer one in 2024 or any other time? I don't have those answers, but guess we'll find out.